Welcome once again. In this session, we're reading Hebrews chapter 3 and 4, the rest of God. The writer of Hebrews says, "Therefore, holy brothers, partakers of a heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Jesus, who was faithful to him who appointed him, as also Moses was in all his house. For he has been counted worthy of more glory than Moses, because he who built the house has more honor than the house." Notice they are comparing Moses to Jesus. As Moses was faithful to God the Father, so Jesus was faithful to God the Father. But Jesus is worthy of more glory than Moses, because the builder of the house is worthy of more glory than the house itself. Notice also that it identifies Jesus as the builder of Moses. And many times, and you know in the scriptures, Moses is equated with the law of God. Moses is equated with the Torah. Jesus is the builder of the Torah. It was Jesus who actually built the Torah. Because as we know, Jesus existed before the creation of the world, and he actually partook in the creation of the world with God the Father. So far we've got Jesus like Moses. Remember, Moses said, "A prophet is coming like unto me." A lot of Christians don't view Jesus as being like Moses, but a lot of Christians, unfortunately, view Jesus as being kind of like the opposite of Moses. Like Moses came to do this, but Jesus came to do something totally opposite. But here, and in Deuteronomy, we see that Jesus is likened as unto Moses. Verse 4, "For every house is built by someone, but he who built all things is God. Moses indeed was faithful in all his house as a servant, for a testimony of those things which were afterward to be spoken. But Christ is faithful as a son over his house. We are his house if," notice that if there, "if we hold fast our confidence and the glorying of our hope firm to the end." There are so many times in Scripture that it gives you conditions to being saved. Here again, we will be saved if we hold fast to the end. "Therefore, even as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you will hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as in the rebellion, in the day of trial in the wilderness, where your fathers tested me and tried me and saw my deeds for 40 years. Therefore, I was displeased with that generation and said, they always err in their heart, but they didn't know my ways. As I swore in my wrath, they will not enter into my rest." And that is found in Psalm 95, verses 7 through 11. So that's referring to the children of Israel after they came out of Egypt, and they were in the wilderness for 40 years. And God kept them in the wilderness for 40 years because of their unbelief. He said, "You will die in the wilderness. You will not enter the promised land," i.e., the rest of God. So they were left wandering in the wilderness like nomads for 40 years without coming to their rest. "Beware, brothers, lest perhaps there might be in any one of you an evil heart of unbelief in falling away from the living God. But exhort one another day by day, so long as it's called today, lest any one of you be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. So we have become partakers of Christ, if there's another big if there, if we hold the beginning of our confidence firm to the end. While it is said, today, if you will hear his voice, don't harden your hearts as in the rebellion. For who, when they heard, rebelled? Wasn't it all those who came out of Egypt led by Moses? With whom was he displeased 40 years? Wasn't it with those who sinned, whose bodies fell in the wilderness? To whom did he swear that they wouldn't enter into his rest, but to those who were disobedient?" Here it's nailing it right to the floor. Disobedience is the thing. Okay, it talks about unbelief, but the original Greek word for unbelief also means disobedience. Belief and obedience are synonymous, as unbelief and disobedience are synonymous. You can't say, well, I believe in Jesus, if you don't really live like the way he wants you to live. If you don't live like him, then how can you say you fully believe in him? Verse 18 again, to whom did he swear that they wouldn't enter into his rest, but to those who were disobedient? We see that they weren't able to enter in because of unbelief. There we go again. Unbelief and disobedience, hand in hand. Hebrews chapter 4, let's fear therefore, lest perhaps any one of you should seem to have come short of a promise of entering into his rest. For indeed, we have had good news preached to us, even as they also did. Remember, it's the same gospel, as it says in the book of Galatians, the gospel was preached to Abraham. But the word that they heard didn't profit them, because it wasn't mixed with faith by those who heard. For we who have believed do enter into that rest, even as he has said, as I swore in my wrath, they will not enter into my rest, although the works were finished from the foundation of the world. For he has said this somewhere about the seventh day. God rested on the seventh day from all his works. And in this place again, they will not enter into my rest. Seeing therefore it remains that some should enter into it, and they to whom the good news was preached before failed to enter in because of disobedience, he again defines a certain day today, saying through David, so long a time afterward, just as has been said, today if you will hear his voice, don't harden your hearts. Notice it says here that the gospel was preached to them, to those in the wilderness with Moses. Now, God doesn't have two gospels. He's not a double standard God. He's not a hypocrite. The gospel that was preached to them was the gospel of Jesus Christ. It was the same gospel. Remember also that in the book of Galatians, it says that the gospel was preached to Abraham. So here we got the gospel preached to Abraham, the gospel preached to those in the wilderness. And don't forget, in Acts chapter 7, it says the church, think about this for a second, the church was in the wilderness with Moses. Now, I contend, and I always will, that Christianity didn't start when Jesus first came in the flesh. The church, the called out ones, the assembly of God, the real true church, didn't start in the New Testament. It started way back when. You could say it started with Adam and Eve. You could say it started with Abel. But one thing for sure we know, God doesn't have double standards. He never needs to upgrade because he always does things right the first time. There are no errors with God, so he doesn't have to upgrade. He doesn't have to update. Everything is forever settled in heaven with God. From Genesis to Revelation, from the beginning of the world to the end of the world, as it says in Psalm 119, the Word of God includes everything. Everything in the Bible, the Word of God, is forever settled in heaven. We serve one God, with one gospel, with one Savior, with one baptism, one faith. For if Joshua had given them rest, he would not have spoken afterward of another day. So although it's referencing what happened in the past, it's not exclusively talking about the past, but it's talking about another day coming. There remains, therefore, a Sabbath rest for the people of God. For he who has entered into his rest has himself also rested from his works as God did from his. Resting from your works does not mean that you stop obeying the law of God. I mean, the law of God is in effect no matter where you are in time, no matter where you are geographically. Moses was given the law in the wilderness, and when they came into that rest, when Joshua did bring them into the promised land, when they entered that rest, they didn't throw the Torah away. they obeyed it even more. Likewise, as we enter into God's rest, we obey God even more. Verse 11, let's therefore give diligence to enter into that rest, lest anyone fall after the same example of disobedience. So it's about obedience, not disobedience. Entering into God's rest to rest from your works is about obedience. Obedience to the law of God, not disobedience. That's clear. Verse 12, for the word of God is living and active and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing of soul and spirit, of both joints and marrow, and is able to discern the thoughts and intentions of the heart. There is no creature that is hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and laid open before the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. Having then a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let's hold tightly our confession. For we don't have a high priest who can't be touched with the feelings of our infirmities, in other words, weaknesses, but one who has been in all points tempted like we are, yet without sin. So being tempted is not sin. Let's therefore draw near with boldness to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and may find grace for help in time of need. Until next time, seek him with all your heart. That means get into the scriptures. That means get serious with God. That means pray continually, always meditating upon the scriptures. Seek him with all your heart. And if you do, you will find him. Call upon him, and he will show you great and mighty things. Love you guys.